Before I start, let me give you a sense of who we are and what we do. The name of the company is Skymet Weather Services, but it actually does a lot more. It's a weather and agri risk management company and works a lot with data. And we have been evolving this over the last 15 years. So we collect weather data, we forecast weather data. We also do a lot of agri data in terms of crop patterns, imaging, yield, and things. And we basically work in insurance, with banks, with governments on the disaster management and agriculture management side. So this is something that I kind of thought about and I've made the discussion relevant to the topic that we are a data-driven company. So how does it work? Now, I have been evolving this business, and I'm a journalist by training, and I used to repackage weather data. But as you know, things have evolved and as IoT has developed, what I find that what makes data important is the hardware. That's a part of the picture that's always missed. Maybe because when we talk about the consumer context, we're talking about user data and financial data. I come from agriculture, I come from weather, it's all about sensor data. And the three things that have happened. One, sensor costs have come down. The kind of things you can sense has shot up. Bandwidth is available. Sensors do not take too much to communicate bandwidth. And the solar and battery revolution, you can put standalone remote sensors in any corner of the earth. Even with LEOs, that is low earth orbiting satellites, your communication costs and what you can sense, where you can sense it has massively changed. So we today, you know, and so now you can do cow sensing, dairy sensing, crop sensing, NDVI, VCI, leaf wetness, soil moisture, soil temperature, temperature, humidity, wind speed, wind direction, ultrasonic wind sensors. You've got radar, Doppler weather radars, in which you're able to track every drop of water as it evolves in the atmosphere. We have India's only lightning detection network, where we're able to capture every stroke of lightning as it is occurring. And we can also predict, based on historical data, which is now called AI and ML, because you have a lot of historical data correlations with actual precip, that where is going to strike over the next 30 minutes. On these things are not fiction. This is already there. So what Skymet does is, and we have 6,500 weather sensors of our own. We are the only people who have crop sensors. We've got thousands of them. We've got the lightning. We have India's single largest civilian drone fleet, which on which we are loading all kinds of sensors, not only just optical imaging, but hyperspectral imaging, because we want to figure out much more diverse crop patterns. We are right now buying images from Planet Labs and other small satellite players. I think we are also working on putting our own constellation, because these things don't cost that kind of money. And we want to have total control over the data that is being generated. Now, the key thing is when you have so much data coming in, and how do I make sense of it, and how do I monetize it, and give it to somebody to use it? And that's where, you know, we've got our Agromet AI engine that can absorb all these data sets, including cadastral maps. You know, the ownership details, it's from the ownership details of the farms to the crop that has been grown on it, to what has been historically grown, to what are the prices of the commodities that the farmer is growing, and then come up with predictive analytics which can be used both for lending as well as actuarial calculations for insurance. So what are the services we can do? We can do weather. We can do disaster management, we can do pest and disease forecast, crop advisories, autocrop estimation, insurance services, banks. We're actually working with State Bank of India. We're the partners for digital credit risk verification, farm assistance for agriculture, and we also have a retail products that where people can buy our data and services. We have a tie-up with UCAR, University Corporation of Atmospheric Research. This is the mecca of all weather forecasting technologies in the world, where we are taking license for the DICAR system to predict weather at a high geographical resolution. So what are the things that we are actually good at? And these are all, see, a lot of what gets sold as AI has been, or AI or machine learning, has been in domains for years. So numerical weather prediction is all of that, where you have, thermodynamic equations, you populate them with actual observations, and then you make a prediction, which these use supercomputing. Satellite meteorology, how do you take data out of rich satellite imaging as well as data based on and correlating them with ground sensors? And this requires all those things which are now coming up and you know, terms being used in AI and remote sensing. And synoptic data, the key thing, what gives intelligence radar people, synopticians are people who for their lives before computing came used to interpret meteorological data. When you combine all of that with statistical analysis, with some kind of subjective assessment, that's when you truly get a really good predictive forecast, both for crops as well as for weather. Now, the other thing that, you know, this is what I meant. The tools are old, the know-how is old, but you have things that you never had before. You know, this whole discussion of El Nino and sensitivity to the Indian monsoon is because today we have the capacity to sample the Pacific. There are 4,000 buoys across the eastern and western Pacific which are actually measuring the waters of the Pacific on a weekly basis. Mind you, we only figured out that there was a correlation between the monsoon and the Pacific way back in 1921. Then we figured out it was actually the ocean temperatures. And now we have divided the Pacific into 4 points and we're able to get a temperature profile on a weekly basis. How did that happen? These are these specialized buoys with sensors that go all the way down 10 kilometers and then come up and then transmit. Again, it is the hardware, I keep on saying this, that makes it possible. We have never, the world has never sensed itself. We do not need subjective assessments. The word that I hate is assumption. The thing now is that you don't need to assume. You know the objective value. And that is coming into, so this is how it works. You have these massive sensing capacity. You're able to figure out the Pacific. You're able to figure out the correlation with the Indian monsoon. And then that turns into a predictive analysis. So that can tell you that over the next 15 days, if India is going to be dry or if India is going to be wet. So that means, is there going to be a sowing problem or rural distress or you'll be able to sail through or there are going to be many more flood events. Now, in traditional earth sciences, these were not labeled as AI and machine learning, but that's what they always have been. As I said, our sensor network, every time we figure out a sensor, there's a new one on the block. So what we started out as a simple temperature, wind speed, wind direction, humidity, this is our regular sensor suite. Now you've got crop sensing, you've got NDVI, you've got VCI, you've got pollution, you name it, you can put in web cameras, now there are small radio frequency instruments which actually give you a radio frequency, it's just like mini radars that you can put on these things and for about a kilometer it'll actually tell you the moisture in the atmosphere. I'm not talking about moisture as in on a rain gauge. Moisture that is suspended in the atmosphere that you cannot see. All that is now available. Now with that kind of data and intelligence, what are the things you can actually do? So I always loop up to the same thing. It is cheap hardware, communications, and massive storage capacity that allows you to analyze data much more effectively. Because without data, there is no intelligence. So the problem is when you start make inferences, and Mr. Sukiram was saying, when you do not have quality data, and that's when you start getting more false positives. So the key thing is hardware investments. And the kind of crop sensing, for example, I'll tell you, something as arcane as lightning is actually very tangible. There are machines, and I'll tell you how things have changed. So up until 2 years ago, till 2014, a lightning sensor used to cost $60,000 a piece. This is about this big, which had a range of 1,000 kilometers. So if you put a network of about 20 of them, which I did, all over India, from a method of triangulation, it is able to figure out the lightning strike. It is able to figure out if it is cloud to cloud or cloud to ground. 2 months ago, I found out that the lightning chip is now this big. It's for $6 a piece. It's got a range of 40 kilometers. But if I put one chip on 6,000 sensors, I don't need a $66,000 sensor. See how fast things change, you know. So your capacity to sense is massively increasing, and then the capacity to integrate all that data. These are all sensors. Now pollution, for instance. Now PM2.5, PM10, SOx, NOx. 5 years ago, these were very expensive. Today, you get these sensors at less than a dollar. I'm not kidding. It's amazing. And the idea is that you flush these sensors so you're able to figure out the PM2.5 suspension at every street corner, at every factory, at every chimney. That means, actually, now this is where things start changing. So if I have, for example, in Delhi, a continuous data stream of PM2.5 and PM10, and I can figure out when the smog is coming and when it is going, I'll actually be able to figure out which parts of the city, which streets, which areas, which embankments, which industrial areas are more vulnerable than ones that are not. And that has a direct impact on the real estate prices of these places, because there is a tangible health hazard in living with places with high intensity of suspended particulate matter. Now you intelligence, how you look at things changes. Again, because you had the hardware to do it. And we're putting about 200 sensors. The other thing is because we still, in India, India is a difficult place. India is a country where the government has not collected its own data nicely and cleanly. So we ourselves, I mean, there's a reason why Google Maps made the maps for India themselves rather than going to the Survey of India map and integrating them. Because you had to do it yourself. So we collect a lot of farm data ourselves. And we try to reduce model hazard, because if you have to do hundreds and thousands of samples of yield especially, you still need people. And we have the capacity to do that. So we are sampling agriculture at a very rapid rate, which could mean that manual cutting and weighing and drying. Remote sensing, you're gonna hear more and more of this. Drones, cameras are changing it. We use our AI remote sensing tools to expose, we have already done that, to expose insurance fraud in Gujarat. Why? Because there, you see, in India, unfortunately, or how it has been, the government functionary on the ground is a very powerful man, okay? Once he creates a trail of data, nobody on top can negate it. So if a Patwari says, you know, this is agricultural land, not forest land, there goes half the forest. And there is nothing to certify that it is actually forest land. So goes, and this is something that actually plays out in this whole farm loan waiver issue. There is something called a crop zone certificate. Now, a farmer borrows, you know, at 3% or whatever is the rate of interest given by for a farm loan for a certain crop which is based on scale of finance. The scale of finance varies from crop to crop. Now, the certification of what, so there are three moral hazard issues. One, the existence of the farmer. Two, the plot of land that he has, the total size of the land, because the scale of finance will depend on a per hectare rate. Three, what is a crop zone? So you could actually theoretically borrow for a crop that has a higher scale of finance, grow another crop, and then say that your crop was destroyed, get a payment from an insurance company, and sell the crop that has a better, higher remunerative cost, but has lower volume. And that is exactly what happens in Gujarat between for cotton and groundnut. So we created a system where we actually flew the drones. We created and we did it widespread over Rajkot. We took pictures of all the farms. We got the cadastral maps. We linked it to all the bank record. And we were able to expose that 100% of the crop records in Rajkot for cotton groundnut was wrong. That saved the insurance company 800 crores, but that created a lot of political problems. That is one big issue, especially when governance and AI. You start looking under the hood, it will not make sense. And now then the Maharashtra government started using us because it actually saves a lot of money to the government. So we have been deputed by State Bank of India to carry out, to give credit. Is this farmer genuine? What is the map of it cholesterol? What is the crop he's growing? What does the crop that he grows, and what is he asking for the loan for? So again, this is a great intent by the government to reduce the NPA crisis, but it's going to create political problems for itself, because there is a whole ecosystem that actually exists on that leakage. You know, and we are right in the middle of it. My people get beaten, arrested, all kinds of issues to solve this problem. But the key thing is that you can't run away from it. Drones are available. Imaging is cheap. You know, the moment you start linking databases, especially governed databases of land parcel, you are actually looking at a lot of efficiency. So that's what we've worked on. I'll tell you another example. We've got lightning sensors. That means I can track the storm path through any village, exact centimeter land parcel it crossed from. You get a lot of hail damage, or you get a lot of flooding damage, or flash floods. So people come and say, or the DM will declare this whole district is flood affected. But the fact is, no district is ever flood affected. Districts in India are huge. You can drive for 100 kilometers and still be in the same district. You can drive overnight and still be in the same district. So what we do is, we take out the cadastral map. I have the lightning. So these are basically all the lightning strikes. So I know exactly where the storm passed. And then I can figure out where the compensation needs to be given, as opposed to these people where there was nothing. That is the resolution at which you have now data available. This is not fiction. This is actually being done. So that's what makes us risk managers. Now, somebody was saying, Mr. Pedro was saying, how do you find ways to pay for it? I've always believed that there are two people who are willing to pay for new ways of doing things. One is financial sector. You know, banks, insurance companies, always. Second, government. The government is always in India, it doesn't matter how inefficient it is always innovating, it always needs data. And there is an acceptance within government that its own tools of data collection, its own scientific institutions like the Survey of India, Geological Survey of India, with all due respect, IMD, it's not coming together. And states are allowed to innovate on their own, which allows startups to go and do stuff. There are many more startups that are going to come to solve fundamental governance problems. You know, and we find ourselves in the middle of it. We use anything and everything. I mean, I will not go through the laundry list, but UAV, satellite, Sentinel-1, Sentinel-2, Planet Labs, Earthcast. Again, this my guy with this drone, we started using drone 5 years ago. You can go on the internet, do Chris Anderson, who is, the editor of Wired magazine. There is this whole group of people. So if I, who is a political science person, can sit on the internet, buy components from Amazon, put together a flying drone like this, I don't pride myself in being able to use drones. It's not a specialized business anymore. You can create a quadrocopter out of nothing today. So that is how, that's what I meant. So if you are, for example, I made this case. If you are somebody who's working on high fixed costs, those fixed costs become so variable so fast. And it's the hardware that enables you to deliver. So the mastering of hardware, or what I call micro hardware, is key today in any business that you are. Again, satellite images are available, cadastral maps are available, on-field data collection, it's basically repeating. So I can go on and on. So you obviously have data, you warehouse it, you it learns on its own, you put many more layers on it, and you give it to users to use. We've created an AgroMet engine. Let me see if I can give you a demo. So this is not fiction, this is already there. There are three crops that we worked on. Now, these are geotagged images, but if it is cotton, I think it's maize and soybean. If you take a picture from anywhere in this country, which has some kind of geotagging, and if I click it, it is actually able to tell me what crop it is. It's random. What crop it is, where the picture was taken, what is the crop name, what is the crop health, what stage it is in. This is now. I mean, and this is, and all tells you the accuracy, depending on how we have trained the algorithm. We also tell you what risk there is, when that risk is, what is the dry spell or wet spell risk. We can figure out the historical NDVIs, that is the vegetative index, and how the crop actually performs. We can also figure out when it was sown. We can figure out the probable yield. There's a whole crop calendar, and we can also figure out when it's going to come to harvest. From one picture. And this is when we have hundreds of thousands of images collected over the last 5-6 years. Now, the idea is that if I have drones or if I have aerial imaging, I can do large areas. So that is the kind of risk assessment that we are providing to, of all people, the government of India, because the government of India needs to figure this out. If, for example, there's going to be an overproduction of tomatoes, if, for instance, they are staring at a drought in a local area where they need to pay compensations and some local MLA is going to create a problem. All these things are available now. And these think tools, with all due respect, are available not because of as much as I would like to give TensorFlow or any of these Microsoft tools to do it. It's because the hardware or the physical capacity to sample data made it possible. That's where I think the key in my thesis that I would like to share is that we are all becoming consumers of data that is served to us. And as Mr. Sukhiram said, how do I get to the trail if that data is genuine or actually representative of what I'm being told? Especially when it comes to these kind of things, for say weather or agriculture, are very similar to space imaging, signals communication, and defense. And that's where I think as our business, we are again pivoting towards. The government is opening up defense production. We are in drone technologies, the kind of things you can do with it. How do you create simple disposable platforms? How do you do data security, image management, and make sense of it? And because we worked with plants, we're working with a big parliamentary organization on foliage detection, as I mentioned, to figure out if there's actual terrorist infiltration. That's how your experience gets pointed at some other problem solving. So just before I go, I would also like because I come from a weather background, to access, I hope this works, skymedweather.com. Where we have used different IoT layers. Now, IoT is a fancy word, but the fact is that if you were in meteorology or you were in geology, if you were in an oil company, for instance, who for generations have used a huge amount of IoT or automobile, so you always kind of had that. So this is all live lightning strikes right now. These are all live temperatures that you can see. Let me see what else I can show you. This is the live satellite imaging that is available. This is, let me switch off the cloud layer. So again, now this is what I meant. So you see these points, these are precipitation. Precipitation derived from a lightning strike value. So yesterday, we were actually helping the Nagpur Municipal Corporation and the Maharashtra government in tracking the flood in Nagpur real time. And I've got some 8 sensors that is measuring rain in real time. The whole thing is that if you have a flash flood event like that happening, you can figure it out at a street level, half an hour in advance, mobilize people, resources, and as the event is happening, you can figure out how to calibrate your damage and casualties. Now, before all of this, everybody was blind. So that's why I started the discussion by saying that SkyMed Weather Services is somewhat of a misnomer of what we do. We've kind of gone from weather into many more things. Thank you.